The weather has been beautiful today. What's your plan for the rest of the day? Maybe you want to pet your cat while you prepare a meal, or you want to go for a walk? If so, you might infect yourself with a brain parasite which affects over 2 billion people worldwide. Alternatively, you might also get gut parasites which want to share some meals with you. With that, my name is Kevin Steinig, and today we will talk about human parasites which are found all over the world. But first, a short definition of what a parasite actually is. A parasite is an organism which feeds off of other organisms. What is important to emphasize here is that we interact with a lot of different organisms. However, parasites benefit from our existence, but we are harmed by their existence. In other words, they take away nutrients and cause disease. And with that, let's start. The internet loves cats. They are so cute, right? Well, our little furry friends have a dark side. They can give us a parasite. This parasite is called Toxoplasma gondii, and it currently affects over 2 billion people worldwide. This means that at least one of your family members should have this parasite, but how is that even possible? Many people contract Toxoplasma gondii by being in close contact with pets, especially cats. Since this parasite uses cats as its host, we can find egg-like structures in cat feces. However, we also find Toxoplasma gondii in undercooked meat. So in a previous video, we said that overcooked meat can give us a higher chance in developing cancer, and now undercooked meat can give us a higher chance in getting a parasite. So nature's funny, right? Once these inactive eggs have been ingested, they undergo a transformation. Through this transformation, the parasite becomes very efficient in making as many offsprings as possible. This is normally also the point where we might experience some symptoms, as our immune system recognizes that something's going wrong there. However, we mostly only experience mild symptoms, including fever or swellings. But actually, our immune system is quite good in detecting and killing active Toxoplasma gondii, and therefore the parasite has to change its strategy. Instead of facing our immune system, Toxoplasma gondii starts to undergo another transformation and crawls inside our muscles, brain, and eyes. And here it can stay for years. And this is the reason why so many people have this brain parasite. I hope that this fact will always be on your mind. Get it? The good thing is that being infected with Toxoplasma gondii is normally not detrimental. Many of us have this brain parasite without even knowing it. But this whole story becomes much more serious when people with weakened immune systems get infected. If HIV or cancer patients get infected, they might develop toxoplasmosis. Toxoplasmosis can be characterized by more severe fevers, muscle pain, or headaches. In other cases, Toxoplasma gondii can even lead to permanent vision loss. In the US alone, each year Toxoplasma gondii leads to eye damages in over 21,000 people. But again, it can even get more serious if a pregnant woman is infected with this parasite. The reason is that Toxoplasma gondii is potentially fatal for unborn babies. Since babies do not have a fully functioning immune system yet, and they also have to undergo extensive developmental processes in a very short period of time, they are especially susceptible. If an unborn baby gets toxoplasmosis, then the pregnancy might end in stillbirth. Sometimes babies are born but with serious complications. Sometimes symptoms might develop over years, and they might include eye infections, hearing loss, or mental disabilities. And this is the reason why pregnant women should stay away from cats. We normally only treat Toxoplasma gondii in people with severe symptoms or pregnant women. Current drugs against Toxoplasma gondii have often been developed for malaria. These drugs interfere with the cell division of parasites. The main idea here is that we kill the parasite without harming the host, at least in theory. Since Toxoplasma gondii has been shown to become resistant against certain treatments, new drugs are currently being developed. And now we come to our second parasite. You now know that you should not be in close proximity to cats in order to not contract Toxoplasma gondii. But there are many other ways to get parasites, in case you wondered. And while avoiding cats might be possible in spite of being heartbreaking, you will not survive without food or water. And here in food and water we can find contaminations with Giardia lamblia. This parasite is found all over the world. It currently affects over 200 million people, including 1.2 million people in the United States. Normally we ingest inactive Giardia through contaminated food or water and it becomes active in our stomach. Then it reaches the gut and here it starts to reproduce very quickly. Giardia can survive here for weeks and we have just found another buddy who gives us some company. Nearly half of all infected people are asymptomatic, meaning that they do not know that they have been infected. However, children and pregnant women are at higher risk to develop symptoms. These symptoms include abdominal pain, flatulence, or a foul-smelling stool. All of these symptoms can be explained by Giardia messing with our guts. The good thing is that signs of Giardia infections normally disappear within 6 weeks. In this period of time, the main treatment involves rehydration as the body loses a lot of fluids. Other treatments include the usage of metronidazole, which interferes with the metabolism of the parasite. While most of the energy of our cells is produced by mitochondria, hashtag powerhouse of the cell, Giardia does not have functional mitochondria at all. Therefore, it uses other ways to get energy and we can target these ways with drugs. And the drugs are actually quite effective, however, Giardia has also been shown to become resistant against certain drugs and therefore new drugs are currently developed. So, and now we come to worms. We have a worm which has infected over 500 million people worldwide. Imagine you take a walk. You have worked very hard during the day and now it's afternoon and you want to walk through the fields next to your house. As you're crossing one of the fields, you step onto very soft soil. You think, that's weird, and you walk back to your house alone. But are you really that alone? You see, you might now be very close in contracting hookworms. Hookworms are often transmitted between humans through feces. If an infected person defecates outside, he or she will release hookworm eggs. The usage of human feces as fertilizers can also be a source of infection. In this manner, the eggs are released into the soil and they hatch. Once an uninfected person walks over this contaminated soil, the worms will start to penetrate his or her skin. In this process, the infected person might feel itchy or see some skin rashes. And once hookworms have infected a person, they can remain in the gut for years. While some people again do not develop any symptoms, others might experience diarrhea, weight loss, or abdominal pain. In children, even the physical and cognitive growth can be impaired by hookworm infections. What I want to point out is that while delayed growth in children is well documented, cognitive impairments are more subtle. A few years ago, a study in Brazil has associated worm infection in children with reduced concentration and information processing skills. The good thing about hookworm infections is that you can treat them quite easily in only a couple of days. This again includes drugs which interfere with the cells of the parasite, but not the cells of the host. The unfortunate thing is that although we can treat hookworm infections quite well, medical facilities are often lacking in some areas where we have outbreaks. So in order to eradicate hookworms, scientists are trying to develop a hookworm vaccine. In 2017, a vaccine called NAGST1 has been shown to be safe and provoke immune responses in patients. This was a quite small study, and since then several clinical phase 2 studies have been conducted, which seem to be quite promising. As a final point, I also want to argue shortly that human parasites can be valuable for science. For example, scientists are trying to figure out whether we can study hookworms in order to treat inflammatory diseases. Inflammatory diseases are normally provoked by our immune system, and they might, for example, include allergies. The precise mechanism is not clear, but there is an association between worm infections and having lower risks in developing inflammatory diseases. And on the other hand, it is also known that people in areas with high hygiene have higher risks in developing these diseases. Hookworm infections also directly lower the risk in developing dust mite allergies or metabolic diseases. But scientists are just trying to figure out how that works. So I hope that you've seen that there are parasites everywhere, which is kind of creepy. But nevertheless, if you know a topic which is interesting to you, let me know in the comment section and I might cover it in future episodes. And also like, subscribe and hit the bell button if you're new here in order to stay informed about the latest discoveries in life sciences. And with that, I'll see ya.